What up guys, Johnny here from Ignite. Thanks for tuning in again. I'm gonna crack into a special video on the Tempest and Hagseed for those of you out there who are studying Module A textual conversations and happen to be lucky enough to be doing these two texts as your study for this year. So I wanna talk specifically about one of Atwood's motivations, or really a really primary motivation for her writing Hagseed in light of The Tempest. And that is this project called the Hogarth Shakespeare Project. So I wanna start, I do have some sad news, unfortunately, and that is that in 1616, Shakespeare actually died.
Aww.
But there's also good news. Because in 2016, he was revived by Margaret Atwood in Hagseed because of this project. Shakespeare is still alive. His writing is still alive indeed. We know that what Shakespeare explores in all of his plays is very universal in terms of the themes that it covers. But something that is a constant barrier to meaning and to him having an effect on societies over time is going to be language and characters and the values that are actually espoused in his particular plays, which don't necessarily resonate with a contemporary audience who don't share those exact same values, but can nevertheless still understand the universal themes that he was getting at. So what do we do there? We update his work. That is what Atwood has done in light of this Hogarth Shakespeare project, which has basically commissioned all of these writers, modern day writers, to recreate, to revive, to resurrect Shakespeare's plays in the form of a novel. So that's what this project's all about. It's 400 years on, died in 1616, Hagseed came out in 2016, and Atwood was actually asked, or commissioned, rather paid, to write Hagseed as a modern day recreation, and not just a recreation, it's a tribute, but it's also an innovation, it's original as well. It's a spin-off, if you like, it's an adaptation. These are all terms that I'm throwing around that you could use, of The Tempest. We wanna make the themes of The Tempest resonate with a modern day audience, and we also want to extend the play. We want to give the play new meaning, and that's really what this project is about. It's not about simply creating a text that basically updates all of the aspects. It actually elaborates on the meaning. She actually introduces new questions, new perspectives on the original play, and in that way transforms our understanding of The Tempest. We start to look at The Tempest differently because of what Atwood presents in her text, Hagseed. So that's a very important point right there. Make sure you note that down. We are not just talking about simply replicating the same text. We're talking about a mixture of replicating and innovating and making a work of its own. So Shakespeare is still alive. We've got a 400-year anniversary, and we've got these novelists to recreate his plays in the form of prose fiction. That's the exact kind of terminology that I would be using if I was you when you introduce Hagseed. So Atwood actually had an interview with The Guardian in 2016, and it's an article that I would strongly recommend you read. You can Google search it up. Margaret Atwood, Tempest, Guardian. Read the article there, because this is Atwood talking about and reflecting on her process of doing this commissioned piece of work, on attempting to recreate a novel, or rather, on attempting to recreate and actually innovate Shakespeare's play, The Tempest, into a novel form, that being Hagseed. The Hogarth Shakespeare Project has invited a number of authors to choose a play and revisit it in the form of a prose novel. I chose The Tempest. It was my first choice by miles. It contains a great many unanswered questions. These are the curiosities that Atwood had, which compelled her to choose The Tempest, as well as several very complex characters, which also makes it an interesting and engaging task for her. And also, by the way, the complexity and the unanswered questions, notice here, gives Margaret Atwood a lot of leeway to actually innovate with the meaning there, to actually come up with something original that isn't a direct emulation or replica of the play. She can actually try and answer some of these questions. She can try and reflect some of these questions in a contemporary fashion. So, and the challenge of trying to answer the questions, basically what we've just said, and tease out the complexities was part of the attraction. So, basically, I've just paraphrased that. She is engaged and enticed by the challenge of this text, but the main thing is that she is developing the meaning further. And as she does that, and as we look back on the play, we're actually enticed to look at both texts differently. And this is a really important point that I'll flag right now, and we'll cover this in another video, but when we look at The Tempest, when we look at The Hagseed, there is a conversation taking place because of the way Atwood has chosen to adapt and innovate the work of Shakespeare. And that conversation that's created, that dialogue, if you like, between the texts, which is basically a negotiation of meaning and what the play and the novel are about, that is a text in itself. We have a third text, an invisible text, an intangible text that is basically in our minds, which is this negotiation or textual conversation between the play and the novel. And that's a very important point indeed. So, the Elizabethan play has been transfigured. It has gone from a play into a novel. It has changed form. That's an incredibly important word that I would try and integrate into your writing where possible. And on the complexities of the play that Atwood was actually referring to in that article, let's take a look at some of them. And she actually does talk about this in that Guardian article. So, is Prospero a victim or tyrant? And for any of you who have read The Tempest, and you must read The Tempest to fully engage with Hagseed, this is not one of those studies where you can actually get away with ignoring the original text or one of the texts, because they're so interconnected and the study is so dependent on how they've changed in meaning over time. So what about Caliban? Is he oppressed or is he evil? Which way do we look at him? Which way does Shakespeare look at him? Which way does Atwood look at him? And that is obviously a reflection of the way that Atwood thinks that Shakespeare looks at him, but she might also be adding her own spin on the characterization of this. She might be amplifying the goodness of a certain character, or she might be downplaying, by the same token, the evil in another, like Prospero. Perhaps she's giving him the benefit of the doubt, as she says. Is Prospero's island magical in itself? How to suggest that quality in a modern novel? The island, is it a place of trial? Maybe both. These are the questions that she was entertaining when she decided to convert the play into a novel. What happens to the characters at the end of the play? We don't know. It's very ambiguous at the ending, if you remember, or if you look back and read the end of The Tempest, you'll see that we don't know what actually is going to happen when the characters return to Milan. Is Prospero just going to be the Duke again? Is Caliban going to be okay? What happens to Ariel? He supposedly sets Ariel free. So there's lots of unanswered questions that gives Atwood the leeway to tease out. Okay, what does Prospero mean when he says, set me free? Free from what? There is this notion of imprisonment coming out, and Atwood strongly plays upon that notion of imprisonment. We're going to talk about that in a video on themes. And the last complexity of the play, what does Prospero mean when he says of Caliban at the end of the play, this thing of darkness, I acknowledge mine. That is that careful dynamic there between the goodness of Prospero and the evil. The fact that Caliban might not necessarily be so evil and he might not necessarily be so different from Prospero after all. And I think we strongly get that sentiment when we look at the novel. All right, guys, thanks for tuning in. Hope that helped a little bit with your understanding of why this study is important and why it's interesting. I can't wait for the next video when you tune in, but please like and subscribe this video. Tune into our podcast as well if we have this going at the time of the video. That'll be much appreciated. You can listen to us on the way to school or whenever you aren't able to actually watch the video. So I recommend doing that as well. And I'll put a link to the podcast in here or in the description below for you. Until next time, guys, see you later.
Hey guys, thank you so much for watching once again. If you are enjoying our content, and we hope you are, please do like and subscribe to our channel. And of course, share with your friends.
That's right, guys. Thanks for watching. But please do make sure you check out our very special resources. They're quite unique. We've made a whole bunch of state rank practical guides for all your English texts out there. So check out the link now at ignitehsc.com.au. Let us know what you think. Otherwise, we'll see you in the next video.